Oh, the fascinating world of low-budget CPUs. I'm often guilty of focusing a lot on GPU bottlenecks, because if your GPU is struggling with a game, there is so much you can usually do to try and make it better. There are channels out there who love talking about that stuff, I hear. CPU bottlenecks? Very rarely do I find an in-game tweak that improves that. In CPU land, if you have already debloated your OS and made sure there are no other background programs running, you are kinda stuck in a position where for games it either works or it doesn't. This is partially where I have been so fascinated with the Athlon 3000G GPU. At a price of usually less than 60 euros worldwide, this 2-core 4-thread little guy uses a relatively modern CPU architecture and a modern CPU socket, and if paired with a dedicated GPU, it can do amazing frame rates in a lot of titles, and at least 30 FPS in the heaviest CPU contenders out there. Which is why I often recommend it as a stopgap GPU, where you use the integrated GPU for a while, and when you eventually upgrade to a dedicated GPU, it can absolutely kick ass. And in that price range, it was relatively uncontested, even if paired with a GPU. But things are changing. Or are they? So AMD has silently been releasing new CPUs in some markets. What AMD has pointed out is that they no longer have enough materials to keep producing 14 nanometer CPUs, which makes me very concerned for the Athlon supply. But again, I will not mind a 12 nanometer Athlon. Just saying. So, they are now using 12 nanometer Zen Plus materials to produce CPUs while still labeling them as first generation Ryzen and only distinguishing them on the model number in the box? From the same company that brought you, we are making APUs the same series as the CPUs even though they use a different CPU architecture, now comes, this is a box for an old CPU, but this is secretly a new one, and you can only tell by a pair of letters in the label. Essentially, AMD has released in some territories, at time of writing, two of these refactored CPUs, what the community has nicknamed the 1200AF and the 1600AF. So if you see a local store selling a new Ryzen 1200 or Ryzen 1600, check the exact model listing in the website. If it ends with AE box, it is just a regular old first generation Ryzen, but if it ends with an AF box, you might have found some treasure. Most of the press has currently gone to the 1600AF, which is essentially a lower clocked, cheap 2600 for what it's supposed to be a lower cost. But for this video, I wanted to focus on the 1200AF. This is a 12nm Zen Plus 4 core 4-thread CPU that is supposed to retail for less than 60 euros, which is the price I managed to find. Meaning that compared to the Athlon, it has a newer CPU architecture, which means better per-core performance, and 4 real cores instead of 2 cores and 4 threads for essentially the same price. But as you likely noticed, this is only a CPU, not an APU, so it does not include a GPU whatsoever. This means that the 1200AF will always need a dedicated GPU, and that there are no options for a 2-stage stopgap computer. The best way I have seen it described is like a Ryzen 3200G with lower clocks and no integrated GPUs for a heavy discount. But let's say that you are A, looking for an upgrade to an existing computer with an AM4 motherboard and an Athlon CPU, or B, you never intended to do a 2-stage build and you are going straight to the dedicated GPU. What difference does the newer architecture and the extra cores make? When paired with a common, somewhat globally and somewhat cheaply available and potent GPU, like an used GTX 1060, the overclocked Athlon can do competitive games at some really crazy high frame rates. For all examples here, I'm using low settings and occasionally scaling the resolution down to make sure I get a CPU bottlenecked. This is a given for CSGO, but a bigger surprise is Overwatch. When free of the limitations of its integrated GPU and with a hearty overclocked, the frame rate just soars to a different plane. I don't think people are considering 90Hz monitors at this price point, but it is a possibility with a decent GPU. And Apex, which is usually the more CPU heavy of this tree, might drop to 80fps, but will still be theoretically doable with adaptive VSync. The point is, the Athlon is enough of a CPU to play these games comfortably. So, in this territory, while of course the 1200AF is going to perform significantly better, it does not exactly enable an experience that you could not do before. So what about those CPU-heavy AAA games? In my recent video, the more expensive improved CPUs AMD has introduced, I commented on how the three games I tend to use for CPU benchmarking are Assassin's Creed Origins, Odyssey, and Red Dead Redemption 2. With the Athlon, Assassin's Creed Origins at least manages 40fps in crowded areas, which is not a surprise given that a lot of NPC behavior tends to be CPU intensive. Still, if you limit to 30fps, this is a 100% doable thing. Similar story with Assassin's Creed Odyssey, if you're willing to lock to 30fps, you will have a fine experience. Red Dead Redemption 2 is the other recent game that freaking demolishes CPUs when there's a lot of NPCs around, and it dropped even a bit lower than an Assassin's Creed, but it's still right on the range for the 30fps lock. If this CPU can do 30fps on just 3 games, I think it can do at least 30fps on all the games that I have tested myself so far for this channel. So how about that Ryzen 1200AF? For the CPU heavy AAA titles, it gets so close to a 60fps in those NPC heavy areas that I just can't, it's so close. Thankfully, the 1200AF is overclockable and pretty thermally efficient. The base clock is a bit lower than I expected, but it pretty much reaches boost clocks pretty consistently on an open air PC. On a quick test, I was able to get all cores to 3.75 GHz on a 1.35 voltage on a cheaper B350 motherboard and using a cheap power supply. With that overclocking, it just barely manages to scratch that 60fps at full 100% usage on that heavy scene on Red Dead Redemption 2, just barely. Similar story in Assassin's Creed, it can do it, just barely with no headroom. I feel uncomfortably just claiming something like, oh, this CPU can do 60fps on every game. You will probably have to jump to a $100 CPU for that. But the fact that it gets so close on those games means that it will pretty much do the job on most games, and just barely on the heaviest ones, making it not a bad upgrade idea for an Athlon-based PC. It is such a shame that for this AF CPUs, there's a catch. And that, dear friends, is availability and price stability. I have scoured the stores of all sorts of countries and asked for the help of many of you in a vain attempt to figure out if this part is widely available. 90% of the people that found it were in Europe or near Europe. At first, I thought this was simply a release issue since the 1200AF is a very recent development, so it might have just temporarily launched in just a couple of regions, so I decided to look at the similar 1600AF, which has been in the market for a bit longer. The 1600AF is currently available in Europe and the US, and some viewers have pointed out that it's starting to show up in places like Brazil. But as I progress on my list of countries to check, it was harder and harder and harder to find. And you probably notice the issue of price. The 1600AF is supposed to retail for $85 or so, but as you can see, its availability problems have already pushed it to the point that the newer 3100 is looking like a better option. While I was working on this video, the 1200AF started popping up in the United States and it is already near $80, which is difficult to justify. So let's make an experiment. Search in whatever shop you use for local PC parts and check if they have any Ryzen 3 1200 in stock, and check in the serial number if these are AF models. If you do, leave me a comment with the hashtag founded keyword with a link, country and price. If you're one of the lucky people who found one and it's close to its retail price, great! Consider it an almost ideal upgrade if you have an Athlon or similar CPU and a dedicated GPU to pair it with. It is the cheapest quad core that can almost run any game on 60fps. If you can't find one, then you will feel my frustration at how the $60 CPU space right now only seems to have one real global option. Granted, their real option is still pretty good if you have a conservative frame rate standards on the heavier open world games, but considering the difficulties AMD is having on producing 14 nanometer parts, I sure hope we get a Zen Plus or Zen 2 Athlon, or that the Intel upcoming Pentiums change things up, but for the moment, you're kinda stuck with the availability and price lottery of the AF models. If you happen to live in Europe or another region where you win the availability and price lottery, then congratulations. Enjoy your cheap Zen Plus quad core. It's pretty good for the price. But you know what deal never mysteriously becomes worse every day? Nebula. In fact, actually, it gets better with time. What is Nebula, you ask? It is a platform that me and my creator friends have teamed up to build, where creators don't need to worry about demonetization or the dreaded algorithm, and we're thrilled to be partnering with CuriosityStream. Nebula is a place where creators can do what they do best, create. It's a place where we can both house our content ad-free and also experiment with original content and new series that probably wouldn't work in YouTube. Nebula features a lot of YouTube's top educational-ish creators like Half As Interesting, Real Engineering, Legal Eagle, and Fear Sue. And there are new originals coming out every day. Right now, I am watching Wendover Productions' The Final Years of Majuro, a documentary about an island country that is basically going to disappear soon due to the rising sea levels and climate change, and how people are handling the fact that basically their country is going to cease to exist, and damn, the quality of this is outstanding. Have you ever wanted to hear first-hand experiences of people that lived right next to some of the first nuclear bomb testing, and how they were affected by radioactive fallout? Well, there's a bit of that too. What does this have to do with CuriosityStream? Well, as the go-to source for the best documentaries on the internet, they love educational content and educational creators. And we work out a deal where, if you sign for CuriosityStream with the link in the description, not only would you get 1 month free trial for CuriosityStream, you will also get a Nebula subscription for free. And to be clear, the Nebula subscription is not a trial, it's free for as long as you're a CuriosityStream member. Did you play Assassin's Creed Origins and wonder how come it happens on Egypt, but a lot of the top elites and bureaucrats of the pharaoh are Greek? And why are there Greek gods and stuff? The answer is Alexander the Great, which you will know if you watch this fantastic documentary in CuriosityStream. Go to curiositystream.com/lowspecgamer. It's a great way to support this channel and educational content directly for just $12 a year. Just click at the link in the description or go to curiositystream.com/lowspecgamer. Clicking on the link really helps out this channel.